Hi, welcome to LawWiser. Today we would be discussing home buyers and their dilemma around the IBC sector. We all know real estate sector has been in news a lot, and of course at times not really for good reasons. Home buyers have been really concerned about the projects that have been pending and nowhere close to completion. So to understand a lot that is around home buyers, the laws that revolve around it, and how do the other laws impact the home buyers as well. So to understand all this, we have experts with us. We have Senior Advocate Mr. Vivek Sood, and we have Mr. Simranjeet Singh, his partner at Athena Legal. Welcome to LawWiser, and thank you for taking time out for us. To start with this topic, Vivek sir, if you can very quickly explain to us, what is the standing in law of home buyers, especially post-IBC and pre-IBC, if you can explain it to us.
So before I talk about the home buyers in the context of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016, let us understand the pre-IBC world and the post-IBC scenario in a general way. In the pre-IBC world, it was called the debtor's paradise. Now, by debtor's paradise, what I mean to say, the debtors had a great time, you know. You took a loan, the corporates would take a loan, not repay the financial institutions and banks. Matters would go before the BIFR under the Sikh Industrial Companies Act, and the matters would be kept pending for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years before the BIFR and the appellate authority and the Supreme Court. And during this interim period, the incumbent management remained in control of the company. Now, this was the scenario. Now comes the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016. Now, there is a major shift. There is a revolutionary shift that is brought about by the IBC of 2016. It becomes the debtor's hell after the debtor's paradise. I would call it now a debtor's hell. And the equity in the economy has been restored. Now, in the IBC, the important features that I can highlight in the IBC is, first of all, there are strict timelines for the insolvency resolution of the corporate debtor, which means, you know, within 270 days or, you know, extendable by a few months, etc. Within a very strict time frame, there has to be a resolution of the corporate debtor, or else the corporate debtor goes into liquidation. Secondly, the incumbent management is shown the door immediately upon the appointment of the interim resolution professional, the IRP and the RP. The IBC of 2016, prior to the IBC 2016, home buyers, you know, would go to consumer courts, or they would go to the economic offences wing. And now again, there you have RERA. You have RERA of 2016. Of course, you know, I think Simranjeet will explain the interplay between these legislations. But in the pre-IBC scenario, this is what the home buyers did, you know, to recover back their money for the refund or for the possession of the flats in which, you know, they had invested money. Now, the IBC of 2016 was conspicuously silent as to whether the home buyers were financial creditors or operational creditors. The law was silent in this regard. Now, matters were taken to the NCLT, the National Company Law Tribunal, and the matter went to the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. And the tribunals felt that home buyers were financial creditors. They fell within the definition of financial creditors. Because typically in a construction linked plan, you know, where a home buyer puts in money, he gives advance money to the builder, and then he keeps on financing the purchase of the apartment. It was decided that it is essentially in the nature of a commercial borrowing by the real estate developer. So the home buyer is actually giving a sort of a loan. He's financing the real estate developer. Now with this, you know, with this decision, and ultimately the matter went to the Supreme Court. And then some amendments have come into existence also, because earlier on the law was silent. But then in 2018, the law was amended, IBC was amended to specifically bring in the home buyers as financial creditors. And then the question arose that, see, one home buyer can take the company as a hostage. You know, why should one home buyer be able to disable the running of the company? So then further amendments were brought about in 2018, 2020, whereby, you know, certain threshold limits have been prescribed that, you know, at least 10% of the home buyers or 100 of them at least must form a group and then knock the doors of the National Company Law Tribunal. So this in nutshell is the pre-IBC scenario and the post-IBC scenario insofar as the home buyers are concerned.
Thank you for explaining the position of home buyers in such a simplified manner. Simranjeet, if you can quickly explain to us, what is the interplay between RERA, IBC and the Consumer Protection Law when it comes to home buyers and their reliefs?
To thank LawWiser to basically allow us to deal with this particular topic, which is extremely important in today's day and age. And as far as the interplay is concerned, it is extremely essential to understand as to the scope and as to the reason as to why these three acts were brought into play in the first place. IBC as a legislation is, as far as I'm concerned, should be a legislation of last resort when it comes to the aspect of home buyers. RERA as a legislation is the best resort for any home buyer to go and get their disputes dealt with. And as far as the new Consumer Protection Act is concerned, because the Consumer Protection Act has been, the old one has been repealed and a new one has come in. So the new Consumer Protection Act has to basically be seen from the context of as to till what extent can a home buyer go in over there to adequately adjudicate their claims. Now, the problem that comes in is from a judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in Pioneer Urban. In Pioneer Urban, the Honorable Supreme Court held that all the three judicial bodies have requisite jurisdiction to address concerns of the home buyers. So effectively, what started happening was that the home buyers would go and adjudicate their claims in front of all the three tribunals for the very same project. So you could have a project, let's just say project A. There would be about 100 people who would be home buyers in that project A. Because of a delay in that, 10 home buyers would approach the consumer courts under the Consumer Protection Act. A few others would go to the RERA tribunals, as well as certain would approach the IBC, under the NCLT, under IBC. So what started happening was that these courts started passing orders and judgments which were in conflict with each other. So the issue that comes up today and why the interplay becomes so important is that this entire aspect of jurisdiction has to be dealt with at the threshold. Because if RERA passes an order, and RERA passes an order after scrutinizing the entire project as to what is the viability of the project, when the project has come in, it looks at as to how many consumer complaints were there, and then only you get a RERA license. And if a RERA appellate authority passes an order stating that in a certain case, just because there is a delay on the part of the builder in handing over possession, and compensation is the best resort so that the project is completed, At the same time, there were cases where the consumer courts came in and stated that compensation is not the best resort. We would allow refund of the entire amount and allow the home buyer to withdraw from the said project. So because of this conflict, what started happening was that the default on the part of the builders started to escalate to quite some extent. And as you would know, under IBC, a default of is the debt amount as per the statute is 1 lakh rupees of default, because of which then people could very easily approach the NCLT under IBC, file a Section 7 and get an IRP appointed, which would then inter alia lead to a condition where the project was not being completed. So what we see today is that it is the home buyers who are themselves putting putting themselves in the shoes of the builders and trying to complete the projects that were supposed to be completed by the builders themselves. Because of the Section 7 IBC proceeding initiated in the NCLT. End of the day, even under IBC, it is the home buyer who is having to complete the project and take possession. So in that sense, it is best to allow RERA authorities to look at all the projects that are there, because they have the most complete code to deal with this entire aspect. And they are the market regulator now when it comes to this particular field. So they are supposed, the RERA authority should scrutinize every single aspect of the project at large and then come to a conclusion as to whether in an ongoing project should a person be entitled to compensation for the delay that is caused for giving him possession, and as to let the, and to ensure that the builder complies with the terms on which the RERA license has been granted to him with the revised timelines under the RERA license, so that the building is constructed and possession is handed over. Because the same thing is happening under IBC as well, if you look at it, where, as I already pointed out, that the home buyers are now having to complete projects, which is not the intention of IBC in the first place. And as far as the New Companies Act is concerned, I just want to point this thing out. The New Companies Act should be restricted to the limited extent of dealing with deficiency in services. Let's say that the building hasn't been constructed in a proper manner, even though there is adequate safeguard under RERA also for it. But if a person goes to the consumer courts, they should only look at it from the very specific prism of a deficiency in service, rather than put themselves in the shoes of RERA, which is much more capable in dealing with the aspects at hand and which allow for the scrutinizing of the project on a much more granular level than Consumer Protection Act would ever allow for.
Thank you. This kind of really helps us understand how the three laws actually provide for release in different manner to the home buyers. Can you quickly explain to us some recent cases that have evolved, the landscape in IBC for home buyers?
So I will highlight three cases of the Supreme Court, in this regard. The first judgment I wish to highlight is the judgment of the Supreme Court in Swiss Ribbons case. Now, in Swiss Ribbons, various provisions of the IBC 2016 were constitutionally challenged. They were challenged on the anvil of Article 14, that these provisions were manifestly arbitrary, or they were challenged on the anvil of Article 19(1)(g), the right to freedom to carry on business and profession, etc. Now, the Supreme Court, very interestingly, first of all, the matter did not pertain to home buyers. So various provisions were under challenge before the Supreme Court. Firstly, the Supreme Court has highlighted the principle of free play in the joints. That's a very interesting principle, that the legislature, when legislating economic laws, must have free play in the joints. Now, in other words, the legislature must be permitted to experiment when it comes to drafting economic legislations, in the country, unlike criminal laws and other laws. In other words, the Supreme Court has reiterated the principle of, the hands-off approach, that the court must not easily interfere with economic legislations when their constitutional validity is challenged. The legislature must be given, you know, the leverage to try and err, you know, the trial and error method. That leverage must be given to the legislature merely because the economic legislation contains defects or errors will not be a ground to declare these laws to be unconstitutional. The Pioneer Urban, that's a very important decision. Especially in this judgment, the Supreme Court, by creative interpretation, by purposive interpretation, has gone to the extent of holding that home buyers were always financial creditors. So the amendments of 2018 are merely clarificatory in nature. Now, as we all know, the IBC of 2016 was silent insofar as home buyers were concerned. But by creative interpretation, by a proactive approach of the Honorable Supreme Court, home buyers were found to be always there in the IBC of 2016. The third judgment I want to highlight is Manish Kumar's judgment. You know, at some point of time, what happened was one home buyer could actually put the whole corporate debtor, whole company to risk of liquidation. So then, you know, the amendments came that there has to be some threshold limit. So the threshold limit prescribed by the lawmakers was 10% or 100 home buyers. Yes. Now, this was also challenged before the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, the Supreme Court has upheld this amendment in Manish Kumar's case. Manish Kumar case, Simranjit, must be of 2020. I think it's of 2020. Yes. And it's again a very well-written decision where, you know, the Supreme Court says that, you know, we can't give an unbridled license to one home buyer to put the company to ransom. So this putting a threshold is creates a fine balance, you know, between the rights of home buyers and to avoid one home buyer taking the whole company into liquidation. So balance, a fine balance has been struck by the Supreme Court. Now, in toto, you know, the approach of the Supreme Court has been proactive, pro-legislation, pro-experiments, and it gives the opportunity to the lawmakers to continue with these experiments in the times to come.
Thank you for pointing out these three laws. You know, they actually help us understand how position of home buyers has gradually evolved, especially in IBC. And moving on further, Simranjit, you know, we heard these cases. So if you can throw some light on how does the conflict in these jurisdictions, you know, actually three laws impacts the home buyers?
I'll start off on the where my learned senior colleague just left us at. The most important point that Sir basically pointed out over there was the judgment of Swiss Ribbons. Swiss Ribbons very categorically points out that under IBC, the purpose of IBC is not to act as a death knell for a company. It is to ensure that the company survives as a corporate entity and that corporate entity goes further and revives its business. So the interplay, what takes place is that if you look at the orders that have been passed by the consumer courts, mostly the National Commission, they have all passed a strand of orders against various builders across the spectrum wherein they have been allowed for refunds to be given. Now, what happens because of that one particular order is when a refund order is given and the builder has already mobilize the entire fund, which he has taken over a duration of 3 years, 4 years, 5 years from the home buyer, and he has utilized it towards building the entire structure. The amount that is there is not, he does not have the said amount readily available or as ready liquidity to repay the investor immediately. So what that entails is that it then allows the individuals to basically move ahead on to seek execution under the NCDRC, or even in that same context, go and approach the NCLT. So what is happening in this entire process is that the very purpose for which IBC was created, to safeguard a company, is being led astray, where loads of builders who would be able to fulfill the requirements as required under RERA are suffering, as they would have to basically comply with the NCLT norms as well. And by doing so, the company would in the longer run get liquidated, because the asset base would not be that much. So these are the problems that are going on and that are at the core of the home buyer versus builder issue that is there. And this has been more complicated by the judgment in Pioneer Urban, as I had already pointed out, wherein it has very categorically been stated that the home buyer can approach any forum. So it has to be clarified as to under which scenario a particular forum the home buyer should be allowed to approach, so that at the end of the day, the equities can be balanced out between the home buyer as well as the builder.
Thank you for explaining how all of this actually impacts the home buyers. If also you can quickly share your thoughts on the way forward for home buyers now.
Way ahead, as far as I am concerned, is for the government to come out with clear legislation. So an example that I can give over there is that they have to deal with the ongoing projects. The reason why I point out ongoing projects is, and ongoing projects are those projects which are defined under RERA, which were pre-RERA coming into force. Because post RERA coming into force, whenever there was a project that was license was sought for a project which had to be registered under RERA, those are being regulated properly under the RERA code. But the problem that we face today in the sector is for projects that were started prior to RERA, but was an ongoing project when RERA came into force. All right. So in that scenario, what tends to happen is that the legislation that was applied for post RERA cases is applicable to pre-RERA cases as well. So if you look at section 18 of RERA, it also allows for refunds. So that particular provision has to be looked at from the perspective of an ongoing project, because the handholding that has to be done by the regulator or by the government, as the government is most certainly trying to pump in a lot of money through the Swami Fund, which is about 25,000 crores, which the government has sidelined for this particular purpose, is for these very projects which are at the fag end of completion. So in those cases, it is incumbent for RERA to basically come out and clearly state that this project is at the fag end of completion, and under those scenarios, Section 18 will not apply and refund can't be granted. And those orders have to be upheld and have to be seen from the context of what RERA brings to the fold, because RERA has been looking at this entire sector as a whole. So for ongoing projects, it is extremely critical that there has to be unison in the provisions of all the three statutes, wherein they are able to deal with how an ongoing project is supposed to be dealt with, wherein it is best to allow people, a committee from RERA, like local commissioners, can be appointed, and they can go and see as to what is the on-ground progress of the project at hand, and then basically allow for further adjudication on those aspects. I just want to point out that the government intent is to revive the sector. You can see it from the policy decisions that they keep on bringing in, as I told you about the fund that they have created. The intent to revive the sector is there because it generates a huge amount of employment, and that is necessary. But that policy and that the intent is not getting translated into effective legislation on the ground. So that has to be dealt with by the government on a very immediate basis.
The context of the IBC, what I feel that the NCLT, that is the National Company Law Tribunal, and the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal you know, need to beef up their infrastructure. You know, I sometimes have appeared before the Delhi NCLT, and Simranjeet will agree with me, you know, that the infrastructural support is not there. You know, the building, the courtrooms, the number of members, you know, so we have a deluge of cases, we have a flood of cases. The law talks of timelines, but the infrastructural support is not there. So, you know, and especially when home buyers have been added, you know, as financial creditors, this flood, you know, will become a deluge. You know, it will become big. It is getting bigger and bigger. It will bloat, and ultimately the timelines will suffer. So I would like to see, you know, beefing up of the infrastructure of the tribunals firstly. Secondly, you know, once the infrastructure is beefed up, then maybe, you know, you could have separate exclusive benches of the NCLT and NCLAT, you know, which hear only matters, you know, of home buyers, where real estate developers, you know, are before the NCLT. These corporate entities are before, you know, the tribunals. And thirdly, I would like to see the legislature, you know, keep on with this experimental process. Keep experimenting with, you know, legislative amendments. Keep fine-tuning the IBC 2016. You know, the problems that arise can be plugged. You can have creative, you know, legislation. You can have amendments which bring India on par with global practices. You know, our law should now be in harmony with the other laws across the other countries. You know, definitely IBC 2016 and the amendments are definitely deterring. They're deterrent towards the builder community. You know, there is a perception in the real estate developers, amongst the real estate developers, that, you know, if you treat us like criminals, you know, how will we grow? So we will all run away. We will all run away with the projects. You are deterring growth in the real estate sector. But, you know, my answer to this is that it's cleaning up, you know, it's cleaning up the sector.
Thank you. This has been quite a fruitful discussion, especially, you know, trying and understanding the laws that revolve around home buyers and how different jurisdiction impacts their positions and what kind of reliefs are actually there. What different forums provide to these home buyers. Thank you for explaining all of this to our audience. Thank you.